How to Be a Footballer by Peter Crouch, read by Peter Crouch. Prologue. I always wanted to be a footballer, of course I did. Not a basketball player, as I get asked on a daily basis, or a roofer who doesn't need to use a ladder, or a zookeeper who can talk to giraffes face to face. We'll get on to all that business in a while. In the meantime, no, the weather isn't different up here, thanks for asking. Glad we've got that out of the way now. You become a footballer because you love football, because you spend your childhood doing overhead kicks against the fencing around the tennis courts in the local park, because you watch the World Cup on telly and fell in love with the goals and the kits and the passion and the excitement and the team song with the rap bit in it. You become a footballer because you keep going, even when the director of football keeps sending you out on loan to non-league clubs, when your early appearances are greeted with laughter and chants of freak, freak, freak. Does the circus know you're here? And you walk off at halftime to see your dad wrestling with a load of fans who've been abusing his son in front of his face. You become a footballer because you trap a ball much better than anyone expects a bloke of your shape and volley it in a way that confuses people who have set ideas about what a player your size is for, and then learn to head it as well as everyone assumes you could anyway. You become a footballer because you love football. And then you are a footballer, and you're suddenly in the strangest, funniest, most baffling world of all. A world where one teammate comes to training in a bright red suit and matching top hat and cane, and glasses without any glass in them. And another spends his evening hiring a Ferrari, parking it outside a nightclub, then lying on the bonnet directly in the eyeline of the girls coming out. A world where players buy cars so big they can't park them, or become so blasé how many sports cars they own, they've forgot they left a Porsche at the train station, even when their surname is incorporated in the registration plate. You look around you and you try to make sense of it all. The player who gets a tattoo of a chimpanzee wearing glasses and Beats by Dre headphones and kissing the barrel of a gun. The teammate whose preparation for a big game is turning up with a Tesco's bag containing the same four items of food every single time. The fellow striker who sends a tweet then replies to it as if it's a text message from a stranger, starting a conversation with himself that the whole world can see. I've seen football change over the past 20 years. I've been promoted, relegated, won big trophies, gone months without scoring, played for my country at World Cups, been bought, sold, loaned and abused. I think I have a good understanding now of how it works. The tactics, the transfers, the endorsements, the nights out, the glory nights, the wild celebrations, the times when you can't even score when you're 2 yards out and the goalkeeper is lying on his back behind you. I've made my own mistakes. I don't have any tattoos, but that's mainly because none of my limbs are wide enough to support a visible image. I've owned ridiculous cars, at least until an infamous run-in with Roy Keane put me right. I've stood in terrible nightclubs listening to music I hated, at least until 10 Days in Ayia taught me a lesson that I could never forget. There have been clothes I've bought that cost more than the industrial sewing machines on which they were made. I have never carried a Louis Vuitton man bag which contains nothing but my own personal hairdryer, but it was close. And so the time feels right to take you inside the world, past the bouncers, round the velvet rope, into the madness and fun and weirdness of life as a footballer. To take you with me on the team bus and show you how the rules work and who can sit where and with whom, to open the doors on footballers' houses and try to understand when an orangery became a must-have accessory. To come with me on a night out where players will be badgered by strangers to do the robot and fellow players will walk in caps despite caps being banned and sunglasses despite the fact it's a nightclub and thus already dark. Walk with me into the dressing room to find out which players refuse to touch a football before a game, to discover why a load of millionaires never have any shower gel, to hear what Cristiano Ronaldo says when he looks at himself in the mirror. Lurk on the back post to understand the perfect technique for heading that incoming cross into the top corner, or cracking it on the volley with the outside of your foot if it swings behind you. Listen to the stories of how to beat that particular defender there and why the fullback charging in at you is not to be messed with, and why a goalkeeper is quite honestly the strangest person you will ever share a penalty area with. We'll go into post-match interviews and make fools of ourselves on social media and try to ensure that we'll never again pay £250 for a haircut that should have cost a tenner. We'll be coached and cajoled by Harry Redknapp, upset Rafa Benitez with an ill-judged leather jacket, and be soothed by the sound of an accordion played by Tord Grip. There'll be some very bad music and some very bad decisions, but it'll be fun, all of it, and like nothing you've ever seen or read before. I'm Peter Crouch. This is How to Be a Footballer. Shall we? Dressing rooms. Come with me inside football. Come with me into the inner sanctum and to all other secret places in football too. The dressing room. 16 players, the manager, all assistants, the medical staff, and yet the man who has all the power is the kit man. Once the kit man has chosen a peg for you, that's it. Every home match, you will be given the same spot. In every away dressing room, the order of players will be the same. Try to sit in a different place and there'll be uproar. Why are you doing this? Why are you doing that now? Just before kickoff in a game, we have to win. There will be method behind this system. You might be put in a little row of mates or groups together by position. Striker with strike partner, central defender with central defender, goalkeeper on the end by himself. At home, your lock will be numbered with a framed photo of you in action by your spot. Ideally with you looking dominant or scoring a goal or generally looking heroic. A little glance at it before you head out onto the pitch, like a visible pat on the back, a fist pump. You've got this, big man. The dressing room at the stadium is a different place to the training ground. They might serve the same purpose, but the vibe is far more serious. You meet before the matches at the training ground, take the coach to the stadium, and the fun stops. You walk into the dressing room and think, this is what it's all about. All the hard work in the rain and cold all week, all the hours of practice in the park after school as a kid, all the good eating, the stretching, the gym work, the early nights, the early-ish nights on weekdays. You arrive at 1:30 for a 3 p.m. kickoff. Some of the lads will be having a last massage, some listen to their music. I'll read the programme from cover to cover and try to find something amusing from when it's pages to read to the lads. Hey fellas, listen to what the captain's written in his column this week. Oh, you're getting a massage. Oh, I forgot. No one talks to each other in here anymore. There are tables of drinks, water, caffeine shots, energy gels, cans of Red Bull, packs of chewing gum. Jelly babies get shared out. Get your hands off the black ones. You know they're my favourite. The best dressing room in the old days was Highbury. The famous marble halls amazed. Then you walked into the away dressing room for your first ever experience of underfloor heating. When you've never tried it before, it blows your mind. Oh my God, lads, the floor is actually hot. We'll be tossing our club-issued flip-flops to one side and strolling about barefoot with a wonder on our faces. Now, of course, it's standard issue in most footballers' bathrooms. It's just how you heat rooms. Back then, it was the eighth wonder of professional football, so this is Arsenal. The Emirates now is great. The home dressing room at Wembley is huge. You can tell that Aston Villa are still a big club by the size of theirs. There's carpet everywhere. The old stadiums hold the strange ones. Fulham, the away one in the cottage at the corner end of the ground. A listed building so small. Anfield, where they were so compact you could hear the other team shouting. Pokey old showers. QPR's Loftus Road squashed and leaking noise from the stands all around. At Anfield, I used to look around and wonder which legends of the past had sat where I was sitting. Whose coat had hung on my peg and wished that they had carved their initials into the woodwork as if you were at school. In England's dressing room at Twickenham, each individual place has a list of notable players from the past who starred in your position. I would have loved to have that over my shoulder. St John, Keegan, Dalgleish, Rush, Voronin. They had character. Too many of the new ones are smart but bland. The ones we used in the new stadiums built in Germany for the 2006 World Cup were comfortable but soulless and difficult to distinguish one from the other. The benchmark had been set for me when I made my England debut the summer before at the Giants Stadium in New Jersey. Each player had their own booth the size of a comfortable bathroom, complete with a lazy boy recliner. At the end of each match, you didn't want to leave. You just wanted some popcorn and the highlights of your 3-2 win over Colombia on a flat screen. The big ones in the Champions League can make you feel like a gladiator. The San Siro, the Bernabeu, the Camp Nou. Oh, all of them, the dressing room is underground. You can feel the noise above you as you get changed. Hear all the whistling as you jog out to warm up. Feel that you're climbing up into a cauldron of hate as you walk out slowly a few minutes later for kickoff. I remember looking down and seeing the hairs on my legs standing up. the bouncing of the fans in the stands disturbing the water in your cups on the table, your shirt shaking in your hands as you pull it on. When it goes wrong, it's a horrible place to be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.